I named today's project Winter Wishes. It's a celebration of all things winter and features imagery that speaks to the joyful nature of the season. It's made from our 6-inch by 9-inch rectangular tunnel book, and you need very little to complete it other than some time for cutting and a few incidental supplies. The kit includes all of the imagery, the tunnel book itself, book rings, and photos of my finished piece to guide you when placing the elements on the pages. Or you can strike out on your own and create a unique to you version. This project is built off of our 6-inch by 9-inch tunnel book. That features a front cover and a solid back cover, and then there are 6 pages inside. And if I kind of line this all up, you can see that unlike our other tunnel books where there's a circle or a square and things get smaller in both directions, on this one the height of the tunnel remains the same, but it gradually gets smaller as you come down to that back page. They're all pre-drilled with 1/4-inch holes, and the kit will also include book rings, one for each of the 5 holes, and then of course all of the imagery will be inside that package as well, and there will be photographs of the front and back of all of the pages in the book so that you have a reference if you choose to do that. So since we're starting with plain old chipboard, that means we need to do something to it, because anything that you put on top of this color is going to be affected by it. So my solution is to just go ahead and put some gesso on there. So I'm using Dina's white gesso. I'm using a mini ink blending tool, and it's just a simple matter of taking some of the gesso. That's probably not enough. And it takes a few minutes to do this. I kind of assembly line this. I like to get it all done, do all of one side, flip them over, do all of the other side, and if I think that there's any place that needs a second coat, then I can go ahead and do that. But it's pretty straightforward. All I'm going to do is just come along here. I'm going to more or less tap over the holes so that I don't fill them up with the gesso, which I obviously don't want to do. That's just another step. I'd have to clean that out of there, and really, who wants to waste the time on that kind of nonsense? So that's it. This is the process. I'm going to put Lumiere's Super Sparkle Paint on next. Now, the other thing that I will do is I'll come in here and I will tap to cover these edges, but aside from that, that's it. It's pretty darn straightforward. So once this is done, and let me just put this to one side, I can finish it up later. Once that's done, it's a matter of going ahead and putting the Super Sparkle on. Now, I'm dry brushing it on. I'm not putting it on with the ink blending tool. I'm not putting a heavy coat of it on. I'm just putting some on there so I get some coverage. And just give me 1 second here, and I'll bring in one that's already got some on it. So, let's see. This is one that does not have any on it, and this is one that does. So, if I hold this up and it reflects in the light, you can just see the color on there. Now, if you have the pearlescent white paint, it would do pretty much the same thing. I tried them both. I liked the look of the Super Sparkle a little bit better. For a winter-themed book, I think that this makes perfect sense. So, the process for doing this is pretty straightforward. I'm going to do this on both sides also. A lot of times, you see that there's paint in the cover. A lot of times I'll pick up paint from the cover. That's actually pretty dry, so I'm going to resort to picking up what's in the jar. And you can see that I'm just lightly brushing this on. I'm not approaching anything near full coverage. It's just a question, of getting some on there so that I get that sparkly effect from the paint. And you take away, if the gesso goes on unevenly, I should have said that a moment ago, it really doesn't make any difference, because by putting the Super Sparkle on, you provide enough movement, enough places for your eyes to rest on and then pick up and move again, that any little flaw in that gesso is really not going to make a darn bit of difference. So that's it. I went ahead and did this to all of the pages. I put my coat of gesso on, I let it dry, I base coated it again if needed, and then I came through with the Super Sparkle. Once that's done, now it's time to start thinking about cutting out all the imagery. And admittedly, that does take a little bit of time, but it's not that big a deal. And then once you get the pieces cut out, what I did was play. I cut out pieces, I laid them out, I arranged them, I moved things, I changed things, I decided what I wanted to hang inside the tunnel, what I didn't want to hang inside the tunnel, and I was very specific about what was going to be on that inside back cover, because when you look, let's just slide this stuff out of the way, when you look at essentially what happens when you open the front cover, you're going to look straight down into that tunnel, and this is the inside of the back cover. And so what I'm going to do next is show you how I chose what I wanted to put back here and how to go ahead and actually get it mounted onto that inside back cover, because the nice thing is it's one big piece that you just have to put in place. So here's the image that I have planned to use for the inside of the back cover, what I will see when I look open the book cover and I look down through the tunnel. Obviously you don't have to do this, although I have set this particular piece up, and this will be one of the collage sheets that's included in the kit. I've set this up so that it's very easy to do, it's ready, it's easy to align. So if you can imagine this collage sheet that had the white border around here, I did not trim down the image itself at all, I simply trimmed off the white. And the intent was, and let's just get rid of this one with the score tape for a second. The intent was if you took and you trimmed this and you aligned it, now obviously yours won't come to you having the holes punched in it, but if you aligned it with the top and the left side, everything would, let me get this on here, everything would align. So again, you have this part when you look down into the tunnel, this is more or less what you're going to see. You don't have to do that. You can arrange other images for your inside back cover, but the kit will include this so that you can do that if you choose. Now, when it comes time to think about holes and aligning and all that other stuff, what I did was imagine again that these, let's turn it this way and we'll pretend that the holes aren't there. What I did was line this up exactly, and then I came through with a pencil and I sharpened it. I want a really fine point on there, and I traced the holes onto the paper. But what I did was I made certain that my pencil was inside. I don't want this at all slanted inward because my hole size will be wrong. Once I had them all traced, it was just a simple matter of coming in with a quarter inch hole punch and then very carefully aligning the punch with the drawing of the hole that's on there and doing that for all five of them. And that's how I ended up with what you see here. Now, if you want to use liquid glue, you can certainly do that, but I like the permanence of score tape. I like the fact that it's one and done, meaning you only get one chance to do it correctly, but I can put it on there and I know the darn thing's never going to lift. So you can see that what happens is when you get this on here, my top and my left are aligned, my holes are all lined up. So then the next step, and this is obviously the back cover, or excuse me, the front cover, but the next step is to get some score tape on here. So I've taken 2.5 and 2.5 and I've put two strips from top to bottom. And then obviously I don't want to cover the holes with the film that is the adhesive that is the score tape, so I've worked all these little bits in and around it. And then the next step is what I'm going to do, and tweezers are going to come in handy to get all this backing paper off. What I'm going to do is take the backing paper off, but I'm only going to take it off partway across the width of the book. And of course now I'm going to be all fumbly and my fingers aren't going to want to work here. See if we can get it up from here. But you kind of have to do this in steps, or at least I've found that I get better results when I do it this way. Meaning if I take part of one side off and expose, and when I say off, I mean take the backing film off that you see me removing here. I find that if I take this off and I expose part of the adhesive, it allows me a little bit more freedom to start maneuvering things without the tape grabbing so quickly, and suddenly I'm basically screwed because things are not where they're supposed to be. So by doing it this way, I'm committing to very little here. I know that I'm not going to have a piece over here get caught and, you know, suddenly I'm stuck in a total mess. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn this like this. Now again, here's my adhesive up here, and I'm going to pull this toward me so I can kind of look straight down on it. What I need to do, see that flap? I'm going to hold that. That's going to be my means to getting in there and grabbing it. And actually, I need to do the same thing here before I get too far and forget to do that. And I have a little bit, you can see if I hold this up, see right here? I have a little bit of score tape that's overhanging the cover. Just gently fold it back in on itself. And I like to actually remove this, and again, because then you discover you've got things like this hanging off and you can fix it. I like to remove it and then put it back on with that corner folded over. I find that it's easier for me to get my hands on it that way. And so let's actually get that one off too. Get a little bit of an edge hanging here. All right, now I can put this back on. So this is probably the most painstaking part of the entire project because you have to be so darn careful when you're lining everything up. So I'm going to come in knowing full well that this corner needs to align perfectly with that corner. And once I get the two of them there, it's not actually that big a deal to get the rest of it aligned. It's a little bit of wiggle and play, but the nice thing is I have so little of the score tape actually touching anything, that I have the flexibility to just pick it up the tiniest bit and move it if I need to. So I'm kind of just playing here a little bit. Now bear in mind that if this goes a little bit off, there are certainly ways that you can camouflage it. So I think this looks pretty good. So I'm just going to give this a little bit of a press, see if I can get this picked up. And then I want to turn this over and kind of eyeball the holes. And I can see that I'm off up in that corner a little bit. And I can just get that off because there's only the littlest, tiniest bit of the score tape touching. And I apologize for taking so long. I know this is probably not very interesting for you to watch, but I wanted to demo the process, and unfortunately there's a little bit of give and take that happens. All right, I think that actually looks better. Again, I'm going to flip this over, and from this side I can see when I look that I'm actually really satisfied with that. So now it's just a matter of taking off the backing paper, rolling this across so that I don't get any wrinkles or lumps, and putting it on. And I'm off just the tiniest bit right there, but that's okay. I can fix that. How am I going to fix that? Well, first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take this over and I'm going to trim this off here so I get rid of this excess paper. And then what I'm going to do is probably edge these with Super Sparkle, and I'll carry that over a little bit right onto this edge of the paper and edge of the book cover. And that way it'll camouflage that little boop right there and do it in a way that's very subtle, and it kind of looked like I intended to bring the color on there. So that's my next step. I'll trim this, I'll fix up that little boo-boo, and then I'll come back and I'll talk to you about the shapes and the images and applying them to the pages and aligning everything and sort of playing around until you get layouts that you're really satisfied with. I want to come back to this one full image on the inside of the back cover for a second. In the last segment, I showed you where I wasn't perfectly aligned when I put this whole image on the cover, and I mentioned that I might want to fill it in with Super Sparkle. Well, what I ultimately decided, after I looked at the edges, I realized that I had missed. Now, you can't see it now because I've already fixed it. I realized that I had missed with the gesso, and I had some areas that needed to be filled in. So I grabbed my ink blending tool, and I was running it along the edge like this to fill in, and realized that it created this little teeny tiny white border all the way around that I actually like the look of. And the benefit is that it really does camouflage this area up here where this full image didn't completely sit perfectly on the inside back cover. So that's an option if you have one of those little boo-boo areas that needs to be filled in. Now, in terms of all the imagery that's included in this kit, I'm going to show you some collage sheets. What actually ends up in the kit may not look exactly like this, primarily because I printed off way more imagery than I needed to actually put on the pages. I needed different sizes, I needed different fill-in kinds of things, so you'll see some variation of these. But all of these pieces are meant for the pages, or the inside and outside of the front cover, or the back of the back cover. So I've given various sizes, as I said, I've been playing around with them. And so when it came time to start to put images on the pages, you can see that I've got a variety of things going on here. I started with things like these baubles, these little Christmas tree ornaments, and I've used some glitter, and I'll show you how I did this to kind of make them look like it's an ornament that's hanging from the top of this page, rather. I've used flowers. There's a variety of different things, and all of this stuff will be included in the kit. The other thing that I've done, this is Christmas, I feel like glitter is a good thing, and so I've used a glue pen and some glitter and filled in some areas using that rather than images, and as you can see, it's pretty effective. So what I want to do is just briefly talk about the images, I want to talk about mirror images, and then I'll move on to showing you about the glue. So when I talk about mirror images, and let's bring in this page. When I set the collage sheets up, oftentimes I'm going to give you, and this is going to be a difficult example to really see the differences on, but I'm going to give you the reverse of them. So if you look at this funny little shape right here, you can see that it's on this side, on this piece, and on this one, it's on the opposite side. So that when these are put together like this, and you flip them over, they look like a front and a back of something. So let's take these off. Actually, the one thing that I do want to tell you, when I laid all of these elements out on all of the pages, once I was satisfied with the arrangement, I took a photograph of everything. It's really the only way, or at least my only way, to remember how I had them set up. And it was, I can tell you, I referred back to them several times. So talking about mirror images for a second, Unlike the Autumn Tidings tunnel book that had a lot of elements that protruded into the tunnel area, I am doing less of that this time. There are only a couple of things that actually overhang into the tunnel, and this tree happens to be one of them. Now, as great as this tree is, one of the things that's just slightly vexing is that there's not actually a line to cut it out on. You can freehand it, that's not the deal. Where it becomes a little bit of a challenge is if you're going to freehand it and you want to use the mirror image on the back because you're going to overhang it a little bit into the tunnel, then you need to cut them at the same time or they won't match, and that is particularly vexing. So I'm going to hold this up to the light where you won't be able to see it, but where I can see that I've got stuff matched up. And once I'm satisfied that this is pretty well aligned, let me bring it back down into the frame. And you know what? That's not right either. So let me try this again. It would help if I had a brighter light. All right, so this is pretty close. Now, I know that I'm going to arrange this to look something like this. I want the trunk to remain on the page, but I want it skewed as far to this side as possible because I want not to obstruct that view down the tunnel to that one image in the back. So kind of keeping in mind that this is what I want to do, I know that I need to mirror this cut right along here so that these pieces match up when the time comes. So if I could pick these up, what I'm going to do is I'm going to hold this up to the light again and verify that I am aligned properly. And once I'm satisfied that I am, now I'm going to grab my scissors and I'm going to come in and I'm going to cut these out together. Again, I'm just verifying because I'm a little paranoid. I don't want to have to do this twice. All right, this is probably close enough. So I'm going to come in. Now, how you cut this out is a very personal preference. You can do wavy lines if you want. You can just make this more or less straight. What I'm doing is kind of using those little brown marks as a guide. Now, admittedly, the stuff that on the side that I'm cutting out is going to overhang this side of the page and will be cut off, but it's just easier to do this all at once than it's going to be to try to finagle it and come back with it. Okay, so if I put this on here approximately like this, and I'm not going to show you gluing it in place, that really doesn't make a whole heck of a lot of difference, but if I put that on here about like this, and then I flip it over, and then I put this one on here about like this, you can see that when the time comes that I, again, disregarding this because that's going to go, but when the time comes that I glue this, I'm going to have a nice match because I cut these out at the same time, and you can see that here. So that's going to be the process. I'm using, this package has been relabeled. Scotch has now called this Quick Dry Tacky Glue, I think. It's the same product. I'm using the fine line applicator because it's so easy to get the stuff on at that point. So for example, these are all images that I cut out from one of the collage sheets, and I know that this piece is going to go here. Now, I could, if I wanted to, I could cut one of these out, and I wouldn't mirror image it because the word joy would be backwards, but I could put that same thing here if I wanted. Now, in some cases I've done that, but in plenty of cases I haven't, so that when you turn the page, what you see in this spot is probably not necessarily what you're going to see here, but it is a possibility. For example, though I haven't trimmed this piece off yet, you can see that I've got the bear going this way with his scarf pointing inward, and the scarf is pointing inward this way. So once this trimmed, it'll essentially be the same thing. And so that's a case where you get the same thing on both sides. But again, you don't have to. Having said that, again, I'm giving you ample mirrored image pieces that you can do that with. So the nice thing about this glue is twofold. The first one is that it dries really quickly, so you don't have to sit there and babysit it and wait for the piece to set up. You can just kind of put it in place and move on to your next thing. So I'm going to just touch a little bit of glue along the stem and on these leaves. And then I'm going to put this in place. Now, I have chosen to be reasonably careful when I put my elements on so that none of them are blocking the holes where the binding ring goes. And that's it. It's that simple to get these images on. It's really just a matter of arranging them in a way that your eye finds pleasing and photographing them so you don't forget the arrangement. So that's it. Let me glue up these pages, and then really what's left is glitter and putting some imagery on the front and the front inside and front outside cover and the outside of the back cover. With all of the images now adhered to my pages, and I'm just talking for now about the 6 inside pages, I can come back and start to add embellishments. And for the most part, I've limited myself to having strings that the bulbs are dangling from or the baubles are dangling from, and I've done some kind of curlicue flourishy things. I'm going to show you how to do both of those, and hopefully I won't forget. I want to show you how you can use some stickles too. Now I'm using Elizabeth Crafts, this silk, superfine silk glitter in the color Antique Silver. You'll see that in a second. And this is Zig's two-way glue pen. Now this is one of those shake it, press to get the product flowing, and you can see that the tip is now blue. When this glue is wet, it's blue. When it's dry, it gets clear. Having said that, this is repositionable glue, so if you make a mistake, you can remove it, but you have to remove it with water. Because it's repositionable, it stays tacky, and so even though you might think that the glue is gone, unless you wash it all off, the glitter will absolutely be attracted to it. I know this because I ran into this problem, and I realized it was the fact that it's repositionable, and you got to get it out of there. So really straightforward to do. Let me bring in my piece of paper. Since I'm dumping glitter on, I'm doing it on a scratch piece of paper, then I can just kind of funnel it back into the package. I'm just going to press the tip of the pen off to the side so that I can make certain that the glue is flowing, and I'm not even trying to make straight lines. That's more or less a futile effort. If you do them kind of curvy like this, then nobody's the wiser and they think that they're meant to look like that. So obviously I don't want to wait too long. I want to do this bam bam and get it done. And then it's just a matter of tapping, and there are my strings. It's that simple. Now you'll notice that there is a little bit of glitter clinging around. That's not stuck there. It's just kind of clinging from surface tack. Once this is dry, and I'm talking 6 or 8 hours, and I know the glue is completely dry, then I'll come back. I can either use a mop brush or my fan brush and just kind of sweep all that excess off. Now in terms of the curlicues, let me find a spot where I can probably squeeze a curlicue in without it looking a little bit overdone. Well, maybe I'll just put something here like this. I don't know. I'll have to think about that. I would suggest, even though you can wash the glitter off to make life simple for yourself, practice with a pen making those flourishy kind of shapes. Practice with a pen on a scratch piece of paper, and then you won't necessarily feel like you have to be practicing on your piece. It allows you the flexibility to make a mistake on paper first and then not have to monkey with it too much. So if I'm going to do a flourish, let's say that I'm just going to make something come down from that flower. Oftentimes you'll see me do that. I'll kind of draw it with my finger before I come in here and actually put it on with the glue. That looks pretty good. Now it's just a matter of getting the glitter on there, tapping off the excess, and there you go. So that's how simple it is. Now, in terms of stickles, mercury glass is a really nice color that works well with the antique silver. If you want to do something like put baubles on your tree, or little, what would be balls on the tree, or little silver elements, whatever they want to be, I can't talk all of a sudden. It's a really simple to do with stickles. This would be a lot harder to do with the glue pen and loose glitter, so I'm not going to show you all of that, but that really is the process. You can kind of pick and choose your places. If you wanted to put some stickles in the center of the flowers to kind of sparkle them up a bit, you can do that. So now let's talk about the inside and outside of the covers. This is going to be my front cover. Let me turn this toward you. There are 3 pieces on here, 3 separate elements that I chose to combine to make my front cover. The stitching that you see on this little banner here, I added with a brown superfine pit pen. It's not a lot, but sometimes it's those little add-ons that really make a difference. If you look at this side, again, all the elements come from the collage sheets. I haven't done anything else to this. Will I put some flourishes on here? I'm not entirely certain. I don't think I want to overwhelm this with anything. There's a lot of glitter going on in the pages. I might do well to just leave it the way that it is. So that leaves us with the outside of the back cover. So this is what you'll see when you look down into the tunnel. This was the very first thing that we worked on. And then I have these other elements. Now, the singing mice, which I think are just adorable, are not really tall. So in order to add some height, I came and I cut out this tree, and you'll notice that there's a piece missing. I'm going to talk about that in a second. What that did was give me some height so that I don't look like I have these little elements all squashed down here on the bottom. The other thing that it's done is give me some depth. If I lay my male mouse here on the top, you can see that he's definitely in front of the tree. So that creates the illusion of depth. But you'll notice that I took this piece off here. I can't find it. I don't know where it is. But if you can imagine this tree sticking out here, and I had him placed kind of here, there was just this little bit of the tree on the bottom hanging out that I didn't like the look of, so I chose to get rid of it. And then I'm going to move him over to the side enough so that I can rearrange his female partner here. And she's holding this shepherd's crook kind of lantern thing that I need to arrange around this hole right here. And I'll do that with glue when the time comes. Will I do something up here? Quite possibly. If you buy the kit, then you'll see all of the pages. I'm going to photograph everything and make certain that they're in that insert so that you can see what I did. This looks a little bare. I feel like I need to put something there. I'm just not entirely certain what it is. You know, I think that this is a really nice winter project. Whether you give it as a Christmas gift, you give it to someone as a memento for an occasion, or you just make it for yourself, it really is a sweet project. It's very much winter, it can be Christmas, but I think that it kind of takes that silly season and combines it all into these really nice elements that create this really nice book.